I am here to present my views on the additional strategies to clean the Ganga River by harnessing natural resources available to us. I am Utsav from Delhi Public School, Lucknow. The Ganga River is not just a combination of flowing waters, sandbars and religious ghats, but is a natural resource key to the health of 500 million people living in its drainage basin, which comes to 8% of the total world's population. The river is neither known by this name at its origin in the Himalayas, nor at the end in the Bay of Bengal, yet its social importance had made it the national river of our nation. Though the river is the describing feature of its basin, the Ganga River system incorporates tributaries from three distinct geomorphic units, encompasses five countries, and thus its well-being is a concern of international interest. However, overpopulation and industrialization have changed the river's water. Fecal coliform, which are the remnants of human contamination in the river, have risen by 5 orders of magnitude on this logarithmic graph, and it shows the urgent need to clean the river. And for that only, a number of initiatives like the Ganga Action Plan or GAP1, GAP2 and the National Mission for Clean Ganga were undertaken, but they did not deliver the desired and visible results. However, it is clearly evident that the political will for the cause exists, but sadly, the accomplishments of the action plans are questionable. To understand what common people think about the issue, a two-day survey was conducted in my school, and the results have been used later also in this presentation. For this diagram, the students were asked if they thought the GAPs have been successful in their mission, and it can be seen that even the school students have a mixed response, as the yes-no-maybe portions are very close to one-third. The limited success is also evident from this table, which shows that the untreated sewage has remained to a constant 55%, which is understandable. The general approach to clean the river has been to install more and more water treatment plants, maybe at the end of each sewage pipe, but electric power remains the limiting factor here. From this graph, it is evident that with such a constant gap between the supply and demand, we do not have surplus power to expend in cleaning activities, and hence we are forced to look out for non-conventional low to no power using approaches to rejuvenate the river. Talking of low power alternatives, river self-purification process immediately strikes the mind. A river can naturally recover from its degradable and oxygen-demanding effluents through a combination of dilution and bacterial decay. While adding waste makes the decomposer active and lets them consume more oxygen, at the same time photosynthesizers replenish oxygen from the CO2 released. Their respective rates are dependent on the amount of oxygen and organic waste in the water, and this is what the upcoming river model uses. This idea of self-purification has been expressed mathematically using the Streeterfeld's equation, which is used to model the oxygen deficit in a river with distance or time. This model is based on the concept that the change in oxygen deficit can be expressed as a function of aeration constant and deoxygenation going on in the river. Plotting the graph with some hypothetical values, it comes out like this. Since this represents oxygen deficit, we want it to be as low as possible. This deoxygenation constant is a characteristic of the river and added sewage, whereas L is the organic waste concentration in the river. What we can change is the aeration constant, and increasing its value makes the graph lower. This aeration constant is dependent on the surface of water exposed to air and the flora of the river, which implies that the change we just saw can be brought about in Ganga by increasing its aeration constant, which will reinforce the self-purification process. But self-purification process is at work all the time, so why it is not working here? The annual natural river water of the Ganga is in 10 to the power 11 cubic meter, while the wastewater we add remains at 10 to the power 9 cubic meter, which culminates into an amazingly low wastewater concentration of 0.45%. The trick here is that the right question should be when it is not working. The problem here is that the wastewater remains constant throughout the year, whereas the freshwater in the river fluctuates massively. We experience flooding in the monsoons, whereas in summers, virtually all the water flowing in the river is wastewater. If we could change this to this, we will be massively increasing the aeration constant for the river in the summers, and hence the self-purification process and dilution will make the organic and inorganic wastes less detrimental to the river. This is what we have to achieve, and this can be done by rainwater harvesting using earth dams. They have been used since a very long time to hold water. They are simple compact structures that rely on their mass to resist sliding and overturning, and they are not to be built upon the main river itself, but rather on the first order stream or the smallest tributaries. A The multi-utilitarian aspects of the earth dams are wide-ranging, as they will use only local natural products and straightforward design procedures with small equipments and less requirements. But all along the way will be highly inexpensive, earthquake resistant, and the water they will store will help the local villages for all their needs. But will they be enough? Let's analyze the numbers of Gomti River Basin, which has 2000 first order streams and is a prominent sub-basin of the Ganga Basin. And it turns out that annually, the basin receives 800 million liters of rainfall, and out of that, the 2000 earth dams can hold 500 million liters. But this is an underestimate, as some of the water does not flow directly into the stream but collects into ponds and lakes. And thus, we must not forget the final piece in our implementation, that is to increase infiltration and storage capacity of the lakes and ponds by defilting them. This process will be beneficial to the local streams and rivers, as it will increase the water table because tributaries originating from the alluvial plain are dependent on groundwater for their discharge. These strategies perform well on the limitations of GAP. In the words of status paper for Ganga River, GAP did not attend well to the issue of environmental flows. Treatment plants operated with frequent interruptions and funding mechanism have been the moot point since 1985. Well, our strategies reduce the load on the river, eliminate the electricity need, and lower the expense. So, gap is not in the Ganga Action Plan, but the real gap is in our understanding of the system for cleaning the river. This survey shows that we think that the river receives water equally from all these sources, but in fact, it has been scientifically proven that the groundwater contributes much more significantly in the river's discharge than wastewater and Himalayan glaciers. Even more surprisingly, it happens that a majority of us have heard about the self-purification process, and yet when asked what their Ganga cleaning strategy would be if they were the minister for GAP, they were heavily opinionated towards the conventional methods and stuck to them even when the option of increasing river volume was in front of them. In fact, students were equally likely to quit believing that the river cannot be clean than to implement the self-purification process. So, we have the monsoonal precipitation, rurally fertile alluvial plains with plenty of human resources. The government is willing to pay the price, the population is ready to participate. However, the optimal procedure for solving the crisis is unknown. It is high time that we change our perspective of river management and start to see the big picture. We are till now only providing point-wise solutions for a larger three-dimensional problem.